Absolutely.
Well, sir, we're coming up on a commercial break. So if you could please stand by. And when we come back, I would like to ask you more about the issues we're facing here in Indiana and where the Constitution Party of Indiana stands on said issues.
Sure.
Okay. All right, sir. Well, thank you, and we'll be right back with you.
All right.
Thank you. Bye.
When they kick at your front door, how you gonna come? Put your hands on your head or on the trigger of your gun? When the law break in, how you gonna go? Shot down on the pavement or waiting in death pool? You can crush us, you can bruise us, but you'll have to answer too.
This broadcast of Indiana Underground Radio is brought to you by Superior Tactical Solutions. Please check out their website at www.superiortactical.com. All right, sir, and we are back. The sir, if you could tell us some of the specific issues that's a hotbed for the Constitution Party here in Indiana.
Well, some of them, I mean, in Indiana, we're striving for the same thing. We want government here conducted according to the Constitution of the state of Indiana. To that end, I mean, we're a party that's big on states' rights. So we think that the key provision of the Bill of Rights is the 10th Amendment, which says that power is not delegated to the United States by the Constitution nor prohibited to it by it to the states, are reserved to the states respectively or to the people. So one of the things we were talking about earlier was the National Guard system, which has kind of been hijacked by the federal government. You know, we'd like to see that system returned to the power of the state. We contend really that the federal government has on a lot of occasions abrogated its responsibility to the people and to the state by interfering unlawfully in areas constitutionally beyond its legal jurisdiction. So we're looking at areas where, I'll tell you a big area of concern to me is Agenda 21, which is the United Nations vision for global sustainability. And you're now starting to see parts of Agenda 21 work its way into both state and federal laws that limit how property owners can utilize their property. So, you know, it limits where and how much pesticides, for example, farmers can use on their land. You know, we think that's an undue burden on the property owner, you know, that limits the ability of farmers to produce. So, you know, we're resisting those kind of things.
Mm-hmm. And furthermore, to me, it's just, you know, one step closer to, you know, some people would call it a new world order, but...
Global government, yeah.
Right,
right.
And that's a very real danger. I mean, when we have a global government, when that global government becomes oppressive, where do you go to get away from it? You know? And the other thing I like about the idea of states' rights is, you know, if you live in New York and you think New York has oppressive gun laws, you know, you can pick up and move to Indiana, where gun laws aren't quite so restrictive. Mm-hmm. You know, and actually, I'm a big fan of the way gun rights are set up here in Indiana. So, some other issues we look at on a state level or a local level is, we're against smoking bans, things like that. You know, let a property owner decide, whether his establishment is going to allow smoking or not, and let him weigh the economic cost of allowing smoking or not allowing smoking, and then let him make the decision.
Right. We couldn't agree with you more. We are a complete free market capitalist here.
This is an anti-state trying to tell people what to do.
Right. Yeah, I was actually, I was smiling because I was actually getting ready to ask you that question on what you felt on the smoking ban. I obviously knew that you're probably, you and your party was against it, but
yeah, smoking bans are a big thing here in Indianapolis. They're running round and round, the mayor has been somewhat resistant to them, but in the end he's going to cave because that's the way things are trending. Mm-hmm. But isn't it my responsibility to decide whether I want to smoke or not?
Absolutely.
I'll admit it out of hand. I am a smoker, but that's not what motivates me here. I'm a polite smoker. If people don't like smoking, I don't smoke in their company, But, you go to places like the airport, and you can't even smoke out of doors in the airport. Now, they're passing it off as a concern for the health of the citizens of Indiana and whatnot, but come on, can you think of a dirtier place where the air is dirtier in Indianapolis than the Indianapolis International Airport?
Yeah, it's true.
Is banning smoking there really going to improve the air quality at the airport? I don't think so.
Right, yeah, that's a very good point.
If you're a club type person and you go out to clubs at night, smoking is part of that lifestyle. You've just got to reconcile yourself to it. Now, if you own a restaurant and you decide you don't want to have smoking there, that's fine. I can vote with my feet and go to another restaurant. Vote with my dollars.
Yeah, and I just don't understand how they're using validation by way of either employees or, like you're saying, customers of a certain restaurant or club, saying that, it's for their health. I don't understand, like you said, how you don't just vote with your feet and just walk off, or, an employee doesn't have to work there. And also, the beauty of the free market, if people are complaining that a certain bar is, allowing smoking, so they don't want to go there, eventually that there's going to be another bar or another club not too far from there that's going to open that's not going to be smoking, because they want to attract those customers in the first place.
Exactly. Well, what this move is, it's a move to get people to not smoke. Now, if you believe that smoking is that great of a public health hazard, then outlaw it. But I'm going to tell you that we tried doing that with alcohol once, and it didn't turn out so well.
Right. Speaking of which, I can't help but this has brought us to another hotbed issue, which is basically drugs. I'm not one of those people that necessarily want to legalize drugs, but I do think it should be unillegalized by the federal government. I do see it as a state right, and the reason I brought that up is, a lot of the things we're facing, not as much in Indiana, but especially in Arizona, New Mexico, California, etc., is the way I see it is, we have practically created those problems. Now they're calling it narco-terrorism. But the same basic principle as prohibition. What do you want to call it? The mafia, La Cosa Nostra, really wasn't a problem, that much of a problem, until we gave them that black market.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yeah. My thoughts on this, and I'll tell you, the Constitution Party says that it's the right of states and localities to restrict the access to drugs and to enforce those restrictions. If the federal government involved in drugs at all, it ought to be involved in just stopping the flow of drugs, illegal drugs at the borders. I'll tell you that personally, I'm probably in favor of decriminalizing marijuana. And you talk about people, we'll talk about, how people be running around stoned all the time and operating their cars. Well, you know, there are already laws against doing certain things under the influence of alcohol. You know, and you can make similar laws prohibiting the same kinds of activity. I certainly don't, you know, want to see people driving around their automobiles impaired, and marijuana, regardless of what people say, does impair your ability to drive, you know?
No, definitely.
Yeah, it's just...
We've already got laws in place that, you know, prohibit what you can do as far as, you know, when you're using alcohol. Extend those laws to marijuana, and, you know, we're not going to have any real big problem. I think it's ridiculous that marijuana is a Schedule I drug.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. My other problem with how criminalized marijuana has become is, you know, we're supposed to be land of the free, yet we incarcerate more than any other country. And let's face it, a vast majority of them are blacks or Hispanics on marijuana charges.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's a real problem. That's a real problem. I mean, and as an aside, I mean, the tax revenue you could realize from regulating marijuana legally would be immense. I think there's something to be done there. I mean, just do the same thing we do with alcohol, you know, make it 21 to buy it, and just enforce those laws.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I just...
The same way we do alcohol.
Yeah, the over-exaggeration with the whole, you know, smoking marijuana, then everybody's going to be trying to operate vehicles and everything, it's... You know, do not a huge number of people do that anyway. And not only that, like you said, just you already have the same laws for alcohol. I don't see how, you know, people see a disconnect between alcohol and marijuana as far as operating vehicles or any type of activities, you know?
Yeah. You know, I think there's a place. I mean, I for example, I wouldn't want to see heroin or casual morphine use, you know. I wouldn't want to see that legalized. I think that's a very real danger. But again, I think that should be left up to state and not the federal government.
Mm-hmm. And sir, where do you what's the Constitution's party stance or view on property taxes? Property taxes?
Property taxes?
Yes, sir.
Property taxes are, we're against property taxes overall. And the reason for that is it's just a way of the government making you pay rent on your property. You know, you'll never really own your property. So, you know.
And, yes, sir.
It's a state issue. I don't like the idea of property taxes. I think the state should have the right to do that. You know, examine that if they want. I don't think it's a good idea.
No, I don't think so either, sir. A big reason being, two big reasons in my book. One, to me, it kind of hinders upward mobility. Like, there's a recreational vehicle, you know, an RV or something I'm thinking about buying, and maybe I can afford the sticker price and maybe the state sales tax on it, but, you know, as long as I own that, I have to keep paying, you know...
The value-added tax on it.
Absolutely. And
because you own it.
Right. And my second problem with that is that, you know, someone works hard their whole life, pays off their house, pays off their car, pays for pretty much everything, all their credit card debt down, everything. So, you know, basically all they have is their energy bill and water bill, et cetera. But they have to keep paying this property tax, which would tend to force them, you know, unless they're really comfortable, just push them more and more towards like a nursing home.
Yeah. Yeah, and you know, it really, really inhibits the ability of you to ever really own your property. You know, you never do own it because you're